welcome to the Berks History Center's October 2017 Beat program on BCTV. My name is Sime Bertolet. I'm the Executive Director of the Berks History Center and your host for this show. I'm joined by Vicky Heffner, Education Curator for the Berks History Center, and we're in the Spring House and Summer Kitchen at the Conrad Weiser Homestead. We have two very special guests, Barry Miller and Lynn Otto, that will be joining us for this program. The Berks History Center Museum is located at 940 Center Avenue at the corner of Center Avenue and Spring Street in historic Central Park. Hours are Tuesday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and on Saturday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. The Berks History Center Research Library is located directly behind the Berks History Center Museum at 160 Spring Street at the corner of 2nd Street and Spring Street. Hours of operation for the Berks History Center Research Library are Wednesday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. and on Saturday from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m.
Become a member of the Berks History Center by joining. For as little as $35, you can become a member. $55 or above receives 4 issues of our historical review. And for members $100 or more, you are now a Gold Star member and you get free admission to all of our second Saturday programs. Memberships include free admission to the museum and research library and new exhibits that we have, as well as 10% off in our museum gift shop. We highlight area artisans as well as a very good selection of books in our museum store. So please join and become a member of the Berks History Center by calling 610-375-4375.
And before we get off the subject of membership and support, I'd like to encourage all of you, if you like watching the monthly Berks History Center program on BCTV, I strongly encourage you to support BCTV. They bring so many wonderful programs of local community interest into our lives. It's an organization we just couldn't live without. So I really strongly urge you to send your contribution to BCTV at 1900 North 13th Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19604.
Again, I'm here at the Conrad Weiser Homestead, and our special guest is Lynn Otto. I had worked at the Conrad Weiser Homestead when I was in college. I spent a summer here, and I was always very thankful for the experience. And I always thought that if there was ever a movie made about a Pennsylvania colonialist, don't you think Conrad Weiser? I mean, he was born in Germany, immigrated to the colony of New York, traveled here to Pennsylvania, and then just did all the exciting things that he did here.
Absolutely. Yeah. Let me know if you get funding for that.
That would be great, though.
Yeah.
That would be a good
that
movie.
That would be.
So I think he was born in 1698 in Germany?
1696
in Germany.
Mm-hmm. He was born into a very large family. However, his mother died very early in his childhood. And there was a famine going over where they were located. And since the mother had passed away, the father thought that perhaps going and visiting the New World would be a benefit to everybody. So eventually that's what they ended up doing. However, one, I think it was the eldest daughter, chose to stay in Germany. The rest came over into landed in New York.
And how old was he when that?
He would have been about 14.
14.
Yes.
And then he was in the colony of New York.
Yes, they were the whole philosophy on those coming over into New York by the British government was really to harvest turpentine and pine tar from pine trees in that area. For whatever reason, the area that they settled, for some reason, did not really yield what they were looking for. And again, they found themselves almost destitute and in poverty in New York.
And at that time was when Conrad Weiser went to live with the native Indians in the area?
That is correct. It's an interesting story in many ways. There are those that say that really the reason Conrad went and his father gave him to the Mohawks for a season was that they just could not afford to feed him. The other theory is that he was sending him to prepare him for something in the future. I think it's somewhere in between both of those that the real story is.
And it certainly prepared him for later in life when he very much became a diplomat, and he worked to keep peace on the frontier for about 3 decades up into the French and Indian War.
Correct. Although at the time this was happening, young Conrad did not see it that way. He talks about his time in the village that at some points in time, depending on what was going on in the tribal area there, he feared for his life, and he talks about going into the shelter that he was staying in and burying under the hides. I don't think at that young age that he really appreciated what was happening. Certainly when he came to the New World and got involved in the Indian negotiations, interpreting, I think the light bulb came on and said, I think that was a really good idea.
And it was the Swatari Creek that the group of pioneers traveled down to come to the Tobahawken Valley.
Mm-hmm. First the Susquehanna and then the Swatari Creek. That must have been, and unfortunately there's not a whole lot of documentation about that, but that must have been a fascinating time. Building some type of boat to carry their possessions and so forth and coming down. But yeah, I really wish we would know a little bit more about that time, because I think that would have been there were some fascinating stories going on there.
And was he married before or after he left New York?
He was actually married in New York and had 4 children before he left New York. When he came here, he was already married, 4 children, and eventually they had 14 children, and 7 lived to adulthood.
And the house that we're in was not the first structure that was built here as a home?
We're pretty certain that that is the case. One of the many things that Conrad Weiser did for us is give us meticulous journals and account books. And in his account book, he talks about paying a certain individual come and tear down our old log cabin. I think in many cases when settlers came down into an area, they threw up a real crude structure until they could get a permanent dwelling. So I do think that was the case, and they did live in a log cabin, probably pretty crude. Also probably had a more substantial building for their animals, because mm-hmm. they were very aware that they were very important. So probably the animals were living a little bit better than they were for the first couple of years here.
And he owned quite a bit of land here in the area as
mm-hmm.
well.
When he died, his acreage in this area was just about 900 acres.
And when did he begin his tanning business? Is that true that he had a tannery?
Yes, and his son Peter actually ran that operation. I don't know that we know exactly when that started. Probably a few years into their moving down here, but I can't give you a real accurate date. But that was definitely something that they were involved in.
And once he moved here, how did the relationship with the Native Indians occur?
That's a very interesting story also. 1731-32, Conrad was on his way to Philadelphia. And in that group traveling down to Philadelphia was an Indian, Chickalamy. And that's where they first met and struck up a friendship that lasted until Chickalamy died in 1748. It is a very, very, very neat story. There's so many things that both of them did for each other. In my mind, it's comparable to them getting along like Lewis and Clark did in the Lewis and Clark expedition. It was a really, really, really special relationship between those two.
And where did Shikellamy live?
In the Indian town of Shimokan, today we call it Sunbury. He was a viceroy and in charge of the rather large Indian town of Shimokan up there. The Shimokan area, the Shimokan town, up until the beginning of the French and Indian War, was one of the largest Indian towns in Pennsylvania.
And the treaties that they negotiated,
mm-hmm.
Can you enlighten me a little bit about that?
Well, the first big one was the Treaty of Lancaster in 1744, and then he was involved in the both treaties of Easton. He was involved in the early 1750s in an Indian conference in Carlisle. So almost any official action that was taken by the British government in that his time period, he had his hands involved.
Another interesting fact about Conrad Weiser is that he spent time at the Effort of Cloister.
Yes.
And the Effort of Cloister encourages not having marital relationships. However, he fathered children during that time, correct?
That is correct. He took his whole family there in the beginning, and Anna Eve and the children decided that wasn't cut out for them, so they came home. So in his years there, he would come home weekends, and through that, four children were fathered. That caused quite a stir at the cloister because of not being celibate. And one of the children that was born and then died as an infant, they wrote some really nasty things about that whole scenario. So I think that was probably one of the reasons that he eventually got out of it. But Conrad in his life, I think, to some degree, was always on a spiritual journey. He was a staunch Lutheran. We had the Topolhockan confusion in this area. And one of his best friends, Peter Miller, was a minister from this area. And Peter decided to go to the cloister. And Conrad followed, took a brother named of Enoch, and lasted for quite a while. But I think the tension between him and the other Conrad Weissel, started to develop, and eventually he just decided to leave.
Conrad Weiser was also very influential in the laying out of the city of Reading.
Correct.
And while on tour with my students, we have the model of Reading, and I often say that he bought several lots in the city, almost giving his stamp of approval that this was going to become a great city,
mm-hmm.
and that people needed to move here and get it going. And he also had a trading post then, too, on what today is Penn Street.
Yes, he had a house in a trading post, a store, in downtown Reading. Was also, after that, was also very influential in getting Berks County founded in 1752. He owned several lots. It's kind of interesting to me that one of the people that actually had a lot very close to him was a man named Christian Busey. He was a German doctor, and he became good friends with Weiser and eventually became an officer in the Pennsylvania Regiment when Weiser got commissioned.
And he served as a judge as well.
Judge, magistrate, he just wore so many hats.
Tell us a little bit about his death then.
It's very interesting reading the whole story of Conrad Weiser and his spiritual journey was one of the very highlights, I think, of his life. But there's a theme where he seems to be a very sickly person. He talked about, at one point in time, he used to write his own correspondence. And he talks about for 6 weeks he could not use his right arm. And his son became his secretary. And there's many, many times when he was on his journey that he was stricken and it took days to recover. Then came 1760, July. He was at the farm here. He set out on horseback to go to Philadelphia and was stricken ill and brought here and died.
Now, wouldn't that make a great movie?
It would.
That would be a good movie.
Let's make that happen.
Lynn, the Conrad Weiser Homestead is owned by the Pennsylvania Historical and Museum Commission.
Correct.
And I think it was one of their early museums established. Is that true?
One of the early ones. When the park was established in the 1920s, it fell under the Bureau of Forestry and Waters. And I believe somewhere around 1945, it changed mm-hmm. over, and the PHMC took ownership in this to this day.
What I always thought very interesting about the landscape here is the Olmsted brothers, which designed City Park, designed the Conrad Weiser Park as well.
Correct. That was a very big feature of the park, and it still is, because anything that we try to do or repair has to fit into the Olmsted plan that was originally set out for here. So we're very fortunate that those early people that created the park actually got them to come down. It's been a very, very interesting and a very valuable asset.
And tell us your hours, please, when you're open.
Sure. We are currently in the summertime. We are open every Wednesday, Saturday, and Sunday during the summer season. We are currently right now open every Saturday and Sunday in September, and then we'll be going to our fall season, where the first and I believe it's the third Sunday of October, we will be open. First Sunday of November, and on November 18th, it's a Saturday night, is our annual candlelight tour, which we always look forward to. We do this a little bit different than most sites, because we pick a year and we follow that theme. This year it's been 1757, and that will follow through into talking about the events at the candlelight tour.
Okay. Well, thank you.
You're quite welcome.
Finishing up our tour at the Conrad Weiser Homestead, and I'm joined with volunteer docent Hal Taylor, who is just going to talk a little bit about the museum that is in the visitor center and we have been seeing shots of. But if you could just enlighten us a little bit about the museum.
Well, sure. After we do the outside tours, we take them into the inside museum there. We have a letter that was written by Weiser that I point out to them that you can get to see his handwriting in English, because I like to point out to them how he knew three different languages mm-hmm. at that point. Inside there we have some replica Indian wampum belts, kind of explain the wampum belts to them. We have the original deed to the property from when Weiser had it originally. The deed was from 1734. We also have a couple of maps in there to show how the route that the Germans took to come from New York down to settle the Topahawken Valley. We have a replica of Weiser's Italian uniform in there. We show that to the people. We have a picture of Weiser's ancestral home in Germany.
Mm.
A woman a number of years ago went and visited Germany, and she actually found where Gross Auschbach was. A picture of it. We have the actual picture of that, and the church where Weiser's mother was buried. We have one thing we had that Weiser owned is a silver spoon.
Mm-hmm.
There were 14 of them in the inventory when he passed away, and in his will, he said he wanted everything sold. So most of his possessions were sold off. but the family still had a number of these spoons, and we have one of them in there. I like to point that out to people. We always get a good laugh saying, this was actually owned by Weiser, and we take a look at it, and I show them the engravings on it.
And do you still end your tours up here by his gravesite?
No, actually, I end my tours down there. The whole tour, I usually give them a movie, lasts about 20 minutes, and we talk a little bit about the movie. Then we come out and talk about the land, and we take them through the Weiser house, down to the spring house, up to the gravesite. We explain the gravesite and again what the rocks.
And what are the rocks?
The rocks are graves of people that were buried here. Some of them are his young children that died here in infancy. His one son's supposed to be buried here. Weiser's buried right here. His father's buried here. A couple of the rocks supposed to be represents Native Americans that died here.
Well, thank you very much, Hal. I think it's important to mention that the Conrad Weiser Homestead, other than one maintenance person that works here, is entirely run by volunteers and the Friends of the Conrad Weiser Homestead. And as a member of the Conrad Weiser Homestead, I know that they also put out a very nice newsletter. So I would encourage you, if you enjoyed this program, to visit the Conrad Weiser Homestead and to also become a member and help support this organization so that it can operate and have craft days and do special events. And it's a really neat place, the Conrad Weiser Homestead. Thank you.
Think about it, the path to terrorism in Berks County. We're here with a good friend, Barry Miller. Seen Barry a lot at the Berks History Center Research Library, doing a lot of research on his latest work, which is Conrad Weiser and the Dispossession of the Lenape Indian during the French and American War. A lot of times you don't hear a polemic title like that.
It looks good in writing. It's not so easy to pronounce.
It's a controversial, and I don't think I've ever heard it discussed before. Tell us a little bit about what you've been doing.
Well, as you know from the interview with Lynn, Otto, the Lenape don't come up in the discussion very often. We hear a lot about Chickahominy and Conrad Weiser as a diplomat, and the number of times that he literally risked his life to try to make peace between the Iroquois or Iroquois, whichever you prefer to say, and the English colonists, and of course the Germans on the frontier. But you don't really hear anything about William Penn's Indians. And we know about the Treaty of Shackamaxon, and we know that William Penn tried to deal honestly with the Indians in the area. Well, the Indians in the area, our Indians, if you will, were the Lenape. And the Lenape were a relatively small, not very well organized. I don't know whether you'd even officially call them a tribe. They don't have tribal status, but they've worked in pretty much semi-nomadic groups throughout what is all Berks County, Bucks County, Chester County, and up into the Allentown area.
Mm-hmm.
That was a relatively large territory for hunter-gatherers. They were able to live very well in what appears to be really a confined area. Well, as more settlers came in, they got squeezed, and Conrad Weiser then found himself in a situation where he had to deal with a conflicting interests, not only of the, what some will say Native Americans, some would say Native peoples. He had to deal with these conflicts, and ultimately he was a realist, and to ensure he found it necessary to dispossess, which is a nice way of saying dis in many other respects, Lenape. Ultimately, in part through his negotiating efforts with the Iroquois, they were forced out of this area and ultimately came back around during the French and Indian War.
Okay, can you shed any light on where was the friction between the Iroquois and Lynn?
you can get different stories from Lenape speakers about that, whether they were truly so-called in the status of women, which is to say not to make war, whether they had been conquered, or whether it was kind of a negotiated arrangement with a more powerful, more organized group to the north, and where they simply decided, yes, rather than fight, since the numbers are so far superior for the Iroquois, that we will simply agree to be kind of a buffer zone between the Iroquois on the one hand and the Europeans that were coming in originally, the Dutch and the Swedish, and then ultimately the English and the Germans. At the time that they made that arrangement with the Iroquois, they could not have imagined how many people would be coming to this area in such a short time. There were perhaps 8,000 Lenape total between here and Allentown and Bethel Township. And there would be as many as 2,000 or 3,000 Germans arriving in a single season, let alone the English, the Scots-Irish, the Welsh. So very quickly, the Lenape were being pushed out. And as a, I think, as a realist, Conrad Weiser decided it was not in his interest or in anyone's interest to try to defend the Lenape.
Well, okay, so what was the benefit that Conrad Weiser was going to achieve by, what was the term,
dispossession.
Dispossession of the Lenape. I mean, what was his reason?
Well, he was only, in this case, an agent for that dispossession.
Okay.
He seemed to agree with James Logan and with the Penn family that it was necessary to sacrifice the Lenape in order to have very good relations with the Iroquois, because they stood between the French and Pennsylvania. So it was very important to have a good relationship with this powerful organization of the so-called Five Nations, eventually the Six Nations. In doing that, though, he did set up the revenge attacks in Berks County, because I think that almost everyone, the Iroquois themselves and the Pennsylvania authorities, low-rated the military ability of this relatively small group. They engaged in terror tactics. Mm-hmm. In fact, when Otto speaks of terror on the Topohokan, they engaged in terror tactics with a relatively small number of men. And they came from three different places. They came basically south along the Delaware. But those who attacked Berks County came all the way from the Ohio Valley, all the way from essentially Pittsburgh, and then north of that around what's today Oil City, and then came over to Shamokin, which you heard mention, and came down the Topohokan path and attacked here. And in fact, the leader of the war party, Piscataman, came out and said specifically he was coming down to Topohokan to get Conrad Weiser.
So, okay, I'm trying to keep the pieces together here.
Yeah.
So,
I've got 45 minutes. Not here.
Not here. Well, and we don't want to give away that because there is, Lynn's going to be, Barry is going to be delivering a program at the Berks History Center on this subject. So we can't give the whole program away now, but there are just some really interesting things that, again, people just don't talk about that much. I mean, again, it's a polemic topic, but it's interesting to say, okay, we're hearing something that hasn't been shed on this.
No, it hasn't, and the exhibit here at Conrad Weiser right now is about the capture of a young Frenchman. And we always hear about the French Indians. In fact, many history books early on talked about them coming from the Great Lakes, these French Indians, coming down from New York, these French Indians. In reality, the Native Americans that came to this area were the dispossessed Lenape.
Okay.
And so this small group that was dispersed out of this area coalesced during the French and Indian War, and they were the ones who attacked this area, not the sort of mysterious French Indians. They would be accompanied by a Frenchman who was not their guide. It was the opposite. He was learning the territory.
Okay.
The French supplied them with food and with weapons, but they then initiated their own attacks and came down here for their own reasons, not simply as tools of the French.
So set up the timeline for me and I guess the audience. The dispossession by Conrad Weiser of the Lenape, that would have taken place or had, is obviously over a period of time, but what was that period of time,
1730s, 40s? 1730s,
exactly. 1730s,
okay. Because they ultimately signed away this area in 1732, and then they were subject to the so-called walking purchase in 1737, which was up through the Lehigh Valley and you know, along the Delaware.
Okay, so if that happened in the 1730s, I mean, this had been festering among the Lenape for 20 years.
That's right, but it goes a step further. There was a deed, a land transfer that Conrad Weiser negotiated with the Iroquois for the land just over the Blue Mountain, and a very large swath of land between the Susquehanna and the Delaware.
Okay.
And that was Lenape hunting territory. The Lenape that had pushed over the mountain now hunted in that area. So Conrad Weiser himself was very much involved with some additional transactions that affected the Lenape.
Huh. So Conrad Weiser was a lot, well, I don't think anybody would have ever thought he wasn't pragmatic, but this really goes to show that he was very pragmatic.
He was.
And he had an agenda. Barry, that's great. I mean, I can't wait for the program. It should be really good. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Well, you're most welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you, son.
Upcoming events at the Berks History Center is our second Saturday program on October the 14th. And we've just heard Barry Miller speaking about Conrad Weiser and the path of terrorism in Berks County while we were on tour here at the Conrad Weiser Homestead. Also on October the 7th is our Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. Tickets are still available and can be purchased day of tour at site number 5, which is 170 Tuckerton Road. It's the Good Shepherd UCC. We are highlighting the architectural treasures this year of Muhlenberg Township, and tickets are $35, and we never sell out. So come on and join us for our Berks Historic Property Tour. Also, October is American Archives Month and Family History Month. Here is BHC's archivist, Stephanie Mihalik, who will share a little more about this national event.
Thanks, Vicky. Hi, I am Stephanie Mihalik, and I'm the archivist here at the Berks History Center Research Library. In October, we will be celebrating American Archives Month as well as Family History Month. American Archives Month is done by the Society of American Archivists, which is the professional organization for archivists here in the U.S., and they use the month of October to promote the value and importance of archives and archival material throughout the country, as well as the work that archivists do in preserving those materials. So we will be highlighting the collections that we have here at the library throughout the month. We just had Ask an Archivist Day on our Facebook and Twitter pages, but if you have any questions or you want to look back on what we did for the day, you can check out our Facebook and Twitter pages and ask any questions that you may have as well for the rest of the month. As far as Family History Month, we have many, many genealogy resources here in the library that you can utilize to do your genealogy or just find out some interesting facts that you may have about your family if they are here, if they are from Berks County. Our library is open Wednesday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., and then we are also here on Saturdays from 8 to 4. Hope we'll see you this month.
Thank you, Stephanie. We are looking forward to hearing more from you on the BHC Research Library this month on social media. I'd like to add the bus trips that are scheduled for the BHC on December 1st through the 6th. It is Southern Hospitality in Savannah, Georgia, and Charleston, South Carolina. And I just got news that this trip will definitely run because we have enough people signed up.
Wow.
We're going to tour Fort Sumter and Magnolia Plantation. And the cost of this trip is $825 for double occupancy. And I will also add that my holiday house tour of historic homes in Delaware on December the 13th, I have only half a bus left. So, and we've not advertised that in the newspaper, so I'm really encouraged with that trip. And if you want to go, I would say call soon. We will be touring Nemours, Rockwood, and historic Odessa, as well as lunch at Catwell's Tavern. And the cost of that trip is $110 for members, an additional $10 for non-members. Do you have a special story to share about Berks County history? Now you can share your local history with hashtag MyBerksHistory, a collaborative community oral history project with the Berks History Center at BCT.
Vicky, sounds like you have some great bus trips lined up, and they should be a whole lot of fun. I'd like to thank Vicky Heffner, as well as our special guests, Barry Miller and Lynn Otto, for joining us this show. And I'd also like to remind the audience to please take advantage and join us on the Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. It's a great tour. You'd have a lot of fun. Also, stop by the Berks History Center Museum and our research library. You'll see some wonderful exhibits and a great facility. Last but not least, thanks for watching. We appreciate you being with us. See you for November 2017 show.